And welcome back to Learn to Enjoy channel. Thank you for subscribing my channel. If not, please do so. In this video, we will cover timer, assertions, variable and functions in JMeter. In my previous video, I have covered a CRUD operations using a HTTP sampler. So I will be using the same script in this video as well, and in my upcoming video also we'll be using the same script. We'll be modifying whatever we will be learning in the courses. Open the script. I'll go to file. Within file we have a open recent section, and within that I'll select a crudoperation.jmx file. In this file you can see there are four requests: get, put, post and delete, and a view results tree as well. So now if I'll execute the test, you will see that each and every request are executed without any time gap. So in order to visualize that, I'll be also adding another listener which will help us to visualize the time along with a view results tree. And now if I'll execute the test, you will see that there all the requests executed one after the other. Yes, so this request, particular get request, execution start time is this, and after that the sample time, the time it took to execute. And if you'll add the both, you will see that it comes to 344. So this is how we can see that each and every request are getting requested one after the other. But as we know, in a real time we do not have such rigorous scenario where user hit each and every request one after the other. Before performing any task, user used to analyze the response which he or she has got. So we'll be adding some timer as well in our test, and we'll see how the timer impact our test. So within a get request, I'll be adding a constant timer, and the constant timer, so I'll be adding a constant timer, and a time gap is of 300 millisecond. After that, I'll be also adding a timer in a post request, and here I'll be using a random timer. So random timer gives us a flexibility where we can define a range instead of a fixed timer, which we can see in a constant timer. Here I am deciding a range. So within this range, so minimum value of the range is 300 milliseconds and the maximum value is 500 milliseconds. 3 plus 2 is equal to 500 milliseconds. So I've given a range instead of a constant time in a post request. Now if I'll execute the test, then you can observe there is some time gaps. Earlier I had encountered a error with a put request and it is 503. Again, you can see this is from 5xx series, so it is from a server side, and here it's saying server is unavailable. Okay, so now what we can do, we can also add some assertion in our test. So let me first execute this, we'll analyze how timer behaves, and then we'll also add some assertion. So here you will note get request took some time, after that post, and then put and delete came one after the other. So as we have used some time gap, so before hitting a get request there is a constant time delay of a 300 seconds, though I have mentioned it below, but as we know because of execution order, so first of all timer will execute and then the sampler will execute. So first there is a time gap of a 300 milliseconds, after that get request is called, after get request is called we have again another timer, and that here we have a time range of 300 to 500 milliseconds, and then post request is called. So let's look into how these were called. So we can see here before post request, we can see here that there was a time gap of a random time gap of a 500 milliseconds between get request and a post request, and the get request also took some time, which is around 989 milliseconds. So after that you can see after 989 milliseconds, so it was executing on 7 seconds, there was around 1 seconds of execution time, and again you can see there is some time gap of a 300 to 500 in a range of a 300 to 500 milliseconds. So this is how timer execute. So in order to show this in a more fascinating way, I'll increase the time gap. So here now I can show you, and with this I'll also add some assertion. So with a get request I'll add some assertion. So I'll be adding an assertion, response assertion. So as we know, with a get request we'll be getting a response code, and the response code will be equal to 200. So as we will get something or the other from a get request. And within a post request also we can add some assertion. So I'll be adding an assertion, but this time different assertion. So post request size assertions, I am adding a size assertion and its size should be less than 2000 byte. I am not aware of the size, so I have given any random value. For put request also we can give some assertions, so which assertion I should use now. So I will be using a duration assertion, so it should respond within some time and it should respond within a 500 millisecond, let's suppose. So these values which I have given, it is just a random value, so I do not know how much time it will take to respond. So it will be verifying with whether we are getting the response within the 500 milliseconds, and the data also we can validate. So the response size should not be greater than 2000 byte, and here we are verifying the message code, the status code which we will be getting, and we have also modified the random timer. So now when I'll execute, you can easily visualize the time gap between get and post request. So first of all, 300 milliseconds of gap, then get request, then we have a gap of around 3 to 5 seconds. Yes, and after that here you can see a 7 seconds and then 12. So there was a time gap of 3 to 5 seconds between two requests, and then we can see these two requests got called one after the other. So here you can see 669 plus 233, which will be equal to 902. So this is how each and every request got called one after the other without any time gap between delete and put request. Let's see about the assertion which we have applied. Okay, so everything passed, and so where we can visualize the assertion. So here response header assertion, everything worked fine, so I won't be able to show something or the other. So let me forcefully make some changes, and now I'll get a response code of a 3XX series, let's suppose 302 redirectional message, which I am expecting when I'm calling this get request. So now it will fail, and yes, it failed, and now I can see whenever there is a failure, I can see we have got some assertion messages that I was expecting 302 but I have got 200. So this is how we'll get a response message, response assertions when something or the other will fail. So this is how we can use assertion and timer in our script. So after that we'll also cover variable and function in this video. So what I'll be doing, so I'll be using a user defined variable from a config file. So within a config element we have something known as user defined variable. So yes, I'll be using this element, and I'll be defining my server name here. Yes, so I'll be defining my server name here, and I will be assigning the value as req res to that variable which is server. So now I have assigned a req res.in to a variable named as server, and now I will be passing that particular variable. So in order to pass the variable in a JMeter, we'll have to see the pattern dollar within curly braces the variable name. So we'll be adding the variable name. So likewise, I'll be passing this particular variable in each and every request. So now I am passing the server name with the help of a variable. This is how we can use a parameterization. So if tomorrow something is going to be changed, now I'm using in currently I'm using in production, but what if I'll be using in QA? So we have something like resreq-QA. So now if I'll change, I'll change at one particular place and it will get reflected in each and every request. So this is how we can use a parameterization. Let me also correct this. So 200, I'll be getting a 200 every time when I'll be hitting this particular request. So yes, so now I have used a user defined variable within a thread group, and now I have assigned the value resreq to a variable server, and now currently I am passing the server, the variable, to each and every request. So now let me execute it once again and we'll show how things are working. So now I have executed once again in between get and post request. There is a time gap, so timer is also working fine with each and every request. Let me show you how the request call goes. So here you can see req res.in. though we have passed a and that particular value we have passed with the help of a variable, and the way we pass as a variable in a JMeter is within a dollar curly braces. This is how we used to pass a variable in a JMeter. Apart from this, if I'll show you the function, so we have a shortcut for a functions over here, and here we have a many inbuilt functions. So we have a list of functions defined by default. So I will be choosing a time function. Yes, I'll be using a time function in order to demonstrate how we can use it. So I'm giving a format, so dd mm yyy and mhh mm and ss. So I have given a format for it, and even if you want to assign return a function to a particular variable, I'm not assigning it to any particular variable. I'll be directly using with the help of a function. So this is how generate and copy. So you can also visualize the output, what you'll be getting. So this is how you'll be getting a output. So 10 22 2020, and then the hour, minute and seconds. So I'll be using this function, and how I can show you in this function. So I'll be just assigning this function with a request name. So this is not a particular use case, but in order to demonstrate I am doing it. You can use it wisely whenever you require, such as whenever you want to generate a report, and with a report you want to attach a time, so that you'll be able to uniquely identify the reports whenever you have executed it, so and so. So in that way you'll be able to get the report with a time concatenation. So now if I'll execute, you can see how the results will look like. So here the get request, and the get request consists of the date, month and year up along with the time, hour and second. So this is how I have used a time functions in my request. You can also use, as I was talking, you can use it with a simple data writer. So using another listener simple data writer, and here if I can say test underscore the function time function, and then so I will be writing the reports to this particular file, test underscore so and so dot csv. So let's see what happens when I execute the test once again. So once I'll execute the test again, so test is executing now. Let's go back to the bin folder. Yes, with the time format. Yes, here you can see I have generated a log file. Let me show you this as well. So here we have the test report. So the same way you can use another listener, simple data writer listener, with the help of which you can write the test report in a CSV file. You can also use this. So this way I have covered timer, assertions, functions and the variable in this video. Thank you for watching this video. Please like and subscribe my channel if video was informative, and also hit the bell icon for more updates. Feel free to drop suggestions in the comment box.